This is Mr. Flip, otherwise known as Family Madrid, and see the various features here indicated by the colors. Very recently, the Philippines sighted a Chinese silver ship near Red Bank, and this is quite alarming because if you look at history, they will always have a Chinese silver ship before they start making a bolder move in the area. This is Mischief Reef, Palawan. Now, I attended a strategic meeting in Japan, January last year, not 2015. And there, strategic analysts from various countries, United States, Japan, Australia, Indonesia, and we made the conclusion that what China is developing in the area is what we call the strategic triangle. The first point of the triangle is already there. When we were talking about it, this is Woody Island, the parcels, the runway there. And the second point of the triangle was being developed at that time, consisting of various artificial islands, already exhaustively mentioned. And if this would run unimpeded, and it appears to be that way, they would be aiming at the third point of the triangle, and that would be Scarborough Shoal. So once they complete this, they're going to have full control of the South China Sea. And this is connected also with the first island chain and second island chain strategy. What is that all about? The first island chain is a line stretching from the Brunei area, cutting through Taiwan and the Philippines, through Japan, all the way to the Aleutians. This is the line of defense of China to prevent other powers from entering the South China Sea. At the same time, it is also their potential takeoff point because of the desire to expand their reach into the second island chain. And the second island chain is a line from Japan to Guam covering the entire Philippine Sea. If they succeed in reaching the second island chain, breaking out of the South China Sea, the Philippines and maybe parts of Japan will fall under their control. Now this was shown already, the artificial island. The first time this came out, a lot of people found this incredible. We said, how could this structure be constructed in the middle of nowhere? But of course, as already indicated, this actually happened. That is the design, that is the actuality in the Pirate Cross Reef area. In May 2015, last year, the National Security Advisor declared in a formal Senate hearing that the South China Sea Road is the biggest security threat to the Philippines. Now, China has become very assertive, but in view of her assertive and aggressive stance in the South China Sea, East China Sea, and other parts of Asia, China, and this is my own words, has triggered a coalition against itself. It is like what's happening you go back to how it was in school, there will be a bully. The bully can probably control all the students, but after a while, the other students will gang up on the bully in order to neutralize the bully. Maybe even seek the help of the principal, other teachers, maybe the police. And of course, in this particular case, the coalition is led by the first bully, the United States of America. A bully does not want another bully to enter the picture. And what does the U.S. have? Well, just several battle carrier groups. And there's Japan also, not a minor power, a major military power at this time. A major in terms of maritime power and also air power. In fact, Japan already declared that they are mulling, expanding the naval patrols to the South China Sea. And because of the situation, Japan has started to walk the walk in terms of defense reform. They came out with their legislative reform to allow Japan to intervene militarily in the South China Sea with a new law. What are these? Number one, before the self-defense forces of Japan were looking inward, just protecting their homeland. But now they're starting to look outward. And they declared if Japan is attacked, or when a close ally is attacked, just a close ally, who could that be? Maybe the US, it could be the Philippines. And the result threatens Japan's survival and poses a clear danger to people. They can react. when there is no other appropriate means available to repel the attack and ensure Japan's survival and protect its people, and the use of force is restricted to a necessary minimum. You know, from the strategic point of view, the predicament of Japan is different from the predicament of the United States. The United States faces a challenge as a superpower, but in the case of Japan, it faces an existential challenge. In other words, they could fall under the control of China. Another big player is India. India already made a very strong statement that they will not hesitate to use naval power to protect economic interests in the South China Sea. And by the way, India is also a very powerful country. They have two aircraft carriers. They virtually control the Indian Ocean, second only to the power of the US Navy. Another emerging power in the coalition is Australia. Australia already expressed their concern about Chinese aggression in the South China Sea. In fact, now they are in the midst of modernizing their navy, particularly the submarines. They are ordering about $50 billion worth of new submarines. It could be from Japan, it could be from Sweden, it could be from Germany. The next power is Vietnam. Vietnam, as already mentioned, has an economy much smaller, a little smaller than the Philippines. But in spite of that, they're able to allocate a lot of resources to strengthen their armed forces. They ordered 6 kilo-class submarines from Russia, and I think 2 or 3 have already been delivered, in the amount of $3.2 billion. You know, in 2013, we approved the new AFP Modernization Act, allocating 75 billion pesos over a 5-year period. This is just one acquisition of Vietnam, amounting to $3.2 billion over a 1-year period against our 75 billion over a 5-year period. So you can see the kind of attitude that they have with respect to security and defense. The American military commander, what I'm showing here is how this whole thing is developing and emerging. The commander of the U.S. Force in the Pacific, ahead of the visit by President Xi Jinping in September, declared that China's claim to territory in the South China Sea, that they will challenge this by patrolling close to the artificial islands built by Beijing. And we kept on waiting for this. China warned that they will not allow the U.S. to violate their territorial waters in the South China Sea. And all of us were, all strategic people were wondering what would be the reaction of China in case the U.S. would finally make its move. And finally, it happened. The U.S. Navy sailed to the South China Sea near the China-built islands in Subirik, very close to Pagasa, using an Arleigh Burke class guided missile destroyer. The U.S. is nothing. What was the reaction of China? Nothing happened. The U.S. challenged China in the South China Sea, and nothing happened. What they did was, they just summoned the U.S. ambassador to protest leadership near the reef. Now let's talk of what Japan is doing. Japan also announced what they call a master plan to destroy the Chinese Navy in battle. And what is this? Consisting of anti-access area denial strategy using shore-based missiles. This is an example of the kind of missiles that they have. They already announced that they will put up a line of anti-ship, anti-aircraft missile batteries along 200 islands in the East China Sea, is stretching for about 1,400 kilometers, and this is designed to block the exit of the PLA Navy into the Western Pacific area. While the installations are not secret, it is the first time that Japan spelled out that deployment that will help keep China at bay in the Western Pacific. Chinese ships sailing from the eastern seaboard must pass through this seamless barrier of Japanese missile batteries to reach the Western Pacific, and this is how it looks like. This is the Philippines, this is Taiwan. If they want to break out, they can pass through here. That's a very narrow area, and they're very prone to ambuscade. You know, in the military, you don't want to pass through a narrow area because you can be ambushed. General Diaz knows that. So they can probably use this area, but this string of islands with batteries of missiles will make it almost impossible for them to pass through without heavy damage inflicted on the reef. And what is my analysis? My analysis is this. Japan's deadly missile battery in the East China Sea area will prevent the PLA Navy from breaking out of the East China Sea into the West Pacific. In an actual conflict, China can be easily blockaded in the southeast. It will be impossible for China to pass to the Malacca Strait and in the Indian Ocean, because the Malacca Strait is controlled by the US Navy. Singapore is the base of FCS vessels there. The Indian Ocean is the playground of the Indian Navy and the US Navy. So it would be impossible for them to pass to that. Now, with respect to the case that we filed in the Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague, we announced the victory. We won the first round because the PCA announced that they had jurisdiction over our case. So, but of course, China immediately responded that they're not going to accept Hague sovereignty arbitration. This is like a mantra to them. China will accept Hague sovereignty arbitration. But my position is this. China cannot ignore the arbitral tribunal. It is easier said than done because of international pressure. In fact, there's an article, Singapore Law Watch, that says that instead of, you know, they're advising China that instead of burning political rhetoric at the tribunal, it would be more productive for China to attempt to make a legal rebuttal and argue why it feels that Article 2A8 doesn't apply in this case. Otherwise, they'd be protected as sore losers, not an upholder of the law. The US also issued a strong warning that the Hague Tribunal ruling will be binding on China. The US noted that the final decision by the International Tribunal, not expected until next year, that's this year, will be legally binding on both the Philippines and China, which have both ratified the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. Legal experts, here's an article from the China Cheap Sheets. It says legal experts now say Manila has a good chance of success based on the court's rejection of China's arguments during the hearing on jurisdiction. Such a scenario would mark the first time an international court has intervened on the matter, something Beijing has been trying to avoid for years. That's why China is so freaked out by this whole issue. And again, according to experts, they would expect to see Western nations placing pressure on China in bilateral meetings and at international forums if the ruling went against Beijing on specific key points, especially on the 9+ line. And the analysis that, and I quote, I think in reality, they will have to pay an international price for it if they do not respect the ruling of the tribunal. Australia, very much in the picture, also issued a very strong statement that they expect that nations will respect the tribunal on the South China Sea. Now, of course, the next development would be China started militarizing the artificial islands. They had test flights, this was already by Justice Carpio. They used big planes, not Piper Cubs, but big planes to show the full potential of firing of the runway, the fire cross reef. And the US issued a statement opposing this runway test because they know that this is it shows the potential use of the islands, of the artificial islands. They always claim that this is for civilian purposes, but in my opinion, this has a very big potential for military purposes. And this is my analysis. China's runways and artificial islands can be considered a danger to the Philippines. The Philippines should join the United States, Japan, and Vietnam in vigorously opposing China's test flights and apparent militarization of the artificial islands, as they constitute a very serious danger to the Philippines and the region. According to a study by the Japan Ministry of Defense, and I'm going to show this, the following are the possible impact of the runways being built in three artificial islands in Pirate Cross Reef, Subi Reef, which is 12 miles from our Pagasa Island, and Mystic Reef, which is well within our exclusive economic zone. Here's a picture of Subi Reef taken from Pagasa Island, and you can see how close it is. you can see it be crazy. It's like you are in